Pick another topic now to get your goat going. In the UK, leading politicians are admitting that despite tough legislation brought in over the past 50 years, illegal drugs have become more accessible. Vast amounts of money spent on crackdowns have been wasted, while international criminals have made fortunes. They have now set up a new parliamentary group which will look at drawing up new drugs policies based on scientific evidence. So, in Ireland, are we really adopting the correct approach to curbing harmful drug use? Should we consider decriminalising the usage of some or all drugs? Well, making the case for change, delighted to welcome back to the Newstalk studios Dr. Bill Tormey, consultant chemical pathologist at Beaumont and Connolly Hospitals. He also ran for Fine Gael in the general election and is a Fine Gael Dublin City Councillor and a nominee for the Senate elections that are coming up. And making the case against such legalisation measures is Mary Byrne, founder and director of the Ashley Group International. Chris.
Yeah, you're both welcome along, and we will be speaking to Bill and Mary in just a moment. But first of all, we want to hear from you. What do you think about the war on drugs? Has it failed? Do we tend to look the other way when we hear of a gangland murder because it's just another one? It doesn't usually happen around here type attitude. We want you to join this conversation. You can low-call us, make your point on air, 1890-453-106. Send us a tweet. We will read them out directly in studio at twitter.com. You can find us there. We're at BreakfastNT, or you can text our 30 cent text line 53106.
Bill, Mary, you're most welcome. Now, but perhaps to set the scene, maybe you just tell us how prevalent drug usage is in Irish society in 2011. Mary Byrne.
Well, Ireland now would have one of the highest rates of drug use in Europe, and that would include cocaine use, heroin use, and obviously we have to include alcohol use now, which would be the most misused drug, and which is legalised. And we are now seen as a very liberal country in Europe in general. When I'm working abroad, that's what's coming across. People just find it a place that's not safe because a lot of people are using drugs and they're not in control.
You didn't mention cannabis and THC.
Cannabis is prevalent, and prevalent in secondary school age level. The youngest we would have taken at one stage would have been 10 years of age, and I certainly know in city areas that it would be younger than that. But 10 years
and
age.
Just tell us a little bit about the Ashling Group.
Well, I founded it over 20 years ago, and it was really because someone I knew had a problem with drugs, and it wasn't about whether it was legal or illegal, it was about the fact of the effects of the drugs on the person. And I remember thinking at the time, surely to God you can have an intervention early on so someone doesn't go on to experience the side effects of it. It was nothing to do with being stifling or anything like that. It was to do with basically the person was in trouble, both mentally and physically, from misuse. And when I started to have meetings around these things, I discovered that it was prevalent throughout Ireland and has increased since. So it's really about the effects, and that's what we've done. We've put in prevention programs that we brought in from the United States, where I trained in Atlanta, Georgia. And I've also been running the parent-to-parent organisation in Australia, which is a national organisation.
And over those 20 years, how would you describe the prevalence of drugs? Has it changed?
Well, it's appalling. The age has dropped, the acceptability of it. I think what really bores me to death is when people tell me that there's very little we can do, so what we need to do is just tell them how to deal with the side effects of it. I find that very limiting in its views and thoughts, when in actual fact we've actually done very little to put in programs to help people. I mean, even on the way over here today, somebody was speaking to me about in their own family situation where someone had died as a result of drug use. I think we've been very laid back, and we haven't done anything. And I would go so far as to question even why some methodologies are used without question. Knowing the corruption we've seen in other areas, I am inclined to believe that there's money involved in this as well.
Dr. Bill Tormey, you're welcome.
Thanks, Ivan.
Drug addicts destroy their own lives, those that are closest to them. Why would you conceivably want to legalise it?
Because the purpose of medicine is to reduce harm in society, and doctors' primary role is to do exactly that. And if you're a qualified medical practitioner, primum non nocere, which is the Latin version of at first do no harm, has to be kept in mind, in paramount mind. Now, in Professor Nutt, N-U-T-T, and I don't make it up, was the British government advisor on drugs and health, and he resigned in a row with the Labour government last year. And they produced a report last November in The Lancet which cited alcohol as massively the most, the greatest societal harm. Tobacco is probably greater than that. We legalise certain drugs and we say that they're okay, even though we know they're not okay, but we don't ban them. And the difficulty is that in terms of numbers of people killed, shortening of life, tobacco is miles out ahead. The average consumer of 10 to 20 cigarettes a day loses 10 years of their lives actuarially, which means that they have 10 years shorter than people who don't smoke. Yet we're absolutely consumed by criminalising the use of a whole lot of other mind-altering drugs. And since time immemorial, humans have set out to intoxicate themselves and will always go and do so. And there's really what happens is there's it waxes and wanes as to whether when society gets out of control in relation to drug abuse, particularly alcohol, and you have the Father Matthew temperance movement, and then you have prohibition in the US, and then you go back to having restricted opening hours of pubs, and then you go and you liberalise this. The effect of liberalisation is that more alcohol is consumed, so you reduce the number of outlets again, and you reduce the number of off licences in Dublin City. So it waxes and wanes, waxes and wanes, waxes and wanes.
But what are and you advocating?
What I'm saying is
ecstasy,
this:
ecstasy, cannabis,
yeah. What
heroin,
I what cocaine. I am what I am saying is very simple. I respect adults' right to intoxicate themselves and be stupid. If you're over 18 and you want to behave in a stupid fashion, you should take the personal consequence. The fact that your family, everybody else, has collateral damage is part of that personal consequence, because irrespective of what your behaviour is, you're going to affect, you're going to impact on third parties. And it's a societal and civil rights issue. If you want to ban drugs, you're going to have a huge impact. And the drugs industry, the banning of the drugs industry has led to massive outbreak of HIV in places in the world, particularly in Russia, massive outbreak of hepatitis from dirty needles, deaths unnecessarily because there's no quality control of street drugs and people do not know what they're taking and take inadvertent overdoses. That's particularly in MDMA and ecstasy and these sort of things where people have suddenly died. I am not for one second, Ivan, suggesting that anybody should take any of these. I don't do it myself. What I'm saying is that to reduce harm to society, it is now a position where it looks like it's better to legalise or liberalise or decriminalise the personal use of drugs and control it and reduce the damage.
I'd just like to pinpoint, Bill,
because if you
what
do
is
that,
it you're exactly advocating? Are you saying that you go to your doctor and get a prescription for ecstasy or what?
No, that you do what some of the people who are trying to change the law in Holland are advocating, which is that you have a card and if you want to use drugs, you buy personal drugs in a drugs shop, whatever that is going to be, a licensed drugs premises, over a certain period, and you can only buy a certain maximum for personal use on a swipe card, and that you would never be arrested for taking personal drugs if you had under a certain volume. It's only illegal trafficking in drugs should be banned. Now, I think that it is not practical in Europe to do this unless you can get a whole lot of countries together to do it. Because what happened in Zurich, for example, when they decriminalised the use of drugs in those parks and people were shooting up in the parks, it became a kind of it became like a honeypot for drug addicts all over Europe.
But Bill, we have legal drug shops in which you go in and you buy the drug, alcohol, and it's as big a problem as it always was. So would, you know, ecstasy shops or whatever, just put that into the category of now being okay. It's okay for me to drink, but I would always drink in moderation, but I don't think it's okay for me to take ecstasy. And legalising it, would it not put it in that place?
It would take some of the odour out of it, and there's no doubt that it would increase consumption in certain circumstances. But if you look at the whole societal harm, it would reduce it. There's a phenomenal amount of money and time being spent trying to imprison people and police time, etc., etc., in personal use of drugs, which is farcical. And it's a very highly controversial thing to say that you actually do reduce harm. The Dutch have worked out that it's 15 billion a year you can actually reduce the total cost to Dutch society if you go down that road. The difficulty is that if you don't do the same thing in Belgium and in France, you're going to suck in
the
problems.
Mary, what's your reaction to that proposal?
I find all that very weak, to be quite honest.
And very what?
Very weak.
Weak.
It's all very assuming a lot of things. I mean, at the very opening, and I appreciate doctors' views on these things, and as I said at the start myself, I find them extremely limiting. When you say that their role is to reduce harm, I never thought that was a doctor's role. I actually thought that they were there to look for means for healing. And I find that if that's the best you can do, then I would normally go to somewhere else who could provide more than that. And that's why I think in programs like Sweden, for instance, you see, we keep talking about Holland and it's the medical model of dealing with things and giving them the drugs. Actually, I know people in the government in Holland who are trying to change their situation now back to becoming more restrictive. But we never look at Sweden, which is the lowest rate of drug use in Europe, which did everything we are doing now, which did what Holland did. It had such an increase in addiction that it was the people of Sweden who asked for it to be restrictive. The one thing that they have also is they have drug-free programs that people can go into. You have 9,500 people approximately on methadone maintenance, which is basically legalized heroin, in Dublin City alone. And you have 200 residential drug-free beds that people can go through to come off drugs. If you want to be weaned off an opiate in this country, you've got 23 detox beds, which means that most of those are not coming off. Now, research in Sweden showed after they did that for years that most of those people had died. Now, I don't see how I would advocate that as a cure.
So surely methadone clinics are along the lines of what Bill has proposed?
Well, it's basically free heroin. And if I thought that it worked...
It's not free heroin.
It's man-made opiates, is it not?
Excuse me, some of the things you say are ridiculous.
I don't think so.
Well, I do.
I work with addicts and they're coming off drugs.
Fantastic.
People who come, are they coming off drugs going to you?
Fantastic. The statistics show...
Are they coming off drugs going to you?
That's not a question that I need to answer.
Well, I think it is. If you're advocating change.
It's anecdotal and nonsensical. The fact of the matter is that anywhere in the world, approximately for all drugs, detox programs, about 70% are taking drugs again at the end of 1 year.
Because they have nowhere to go to.
That's an excuse. You're not denying the fact. You're giving
a
reason why. I'm talking about over 10,000 people on taking illicit opiates in the country, and there's probably 15,000 at the moment. It's gone up, going up again. There is no possible chance for the rest of society to start putting these people in guarded hospital beds with professionals detoxifying them. That is just impractical and absurd, and the cost of that is ridiculous. If you get yourself into an opiate addiction situation, you have to take personal responsibility for that.
Not if you're out of your head.
Well, Mary, let's just tease
to
out.
Get there
Bill,
in the
just,
first
just for a
place,
second,
the
must situation.
Take personal responsibility. It is when you're over 18, you have to. Where I really object to this is pushing opiates on the street into kids. And if the thing was decriminalized and you haven't got all of these gangsters who are making a fortune and killing each other right, left and centre, the culture of Dublin where I come from has actually changed. Gangs are going around and freely killing rivals.
And nobody
right,
that,
left and centre.
Supports that bill. And
no,
that's
hold
your
on
end.
For a second.
No, let's,
and
you've had a good
there
talk
is,
at
there
it.
There is
that's
one
your
other point,
that's
Chris.
Your
I
end,
want to pass
no,
one
no,
other
no,
comment.
I want
it is not true. The role of a doctor is a public health role as well. And I am saying that the public health responsibility and responsibility of a doctor includes harm reduction for society as a whole. That's why doctors are against cigarette smoking. That's why doctors are against huge alcohol consumption, because of the damage it does.
Bill, we
to
agree
society.
With your ends about the gangs comment, but it's the means that we want to tease out, the means you have laid out to getting there. And Marion, that's the question I want to ask you, because Bill's argument is a good one, because in your opening statements, you said that in some city locations, you're seeing children under 10 who are taking cannabis, that over the years that you've been working in this field, the average age of drug takers has come down. So in what Bill has laid out in legalisation and tightly controlling this type of a sector, kids wouldn't have access to it. Is that not...
I don't think that's true, because I think when we look at the drugs that were legalised, and that's alcohol or cigarettes, and that's the one thing that I think we'd agree on, is that because they're legalised, and as you said yourself, there can be an increase in some areas of use. And in my experience, even with the head shops, I never saw, it was unprecedented, the amount of young people aged 13, 14, 15 who came into us who were addicted to drugs. And that was when they were...
Because they were available in a head shop.
And going into schools, the young people would say to me, we're not using the other drugs, we're using the legal ones. And I said, why do you think that's better? And they say, because they're legal, they must be safe, because who the hell would legalise them if they weren't?
Bill, that's a very good point. Was this not an unofficial test of legalising drugs? What happened with head shops last year? And we saw... anecdotally, whenever you were out in town, when people had access to head shops, they had gone wacky.
That's correct. What do you think mind-altering drugs are supposed to do to people? It's supposed they chose to make themselves go wacky. That is the point. And the problem for the head shops is that it was kids that was taking it, and there was a societal difficulty with methadone, which was damaging people. And loads of people have been killed from ecstasy. A very small number, given the numbers of people who take these things. And I see no reason why anybody who's smoking cannabis or doing whatever piece of damage to themselves should be sent to Mount Joy for that. I think that is rampant absurdity, and it's a huge infringement in civil liberties. That's where I come from. The fact of the matter is that if you want to have drug, if you want to chase up car drivers who are drugged, etc., that's a separate issue altogether, and I think that's perfectly correct. There are consequences of drugging yourself, and you should take the consequences. I'm saying that. What I'm also saying quite clearly is that the societal damage to the Western world of the drugs war is massively greater than any benefit that accrues to society from suppressing a number of people taking drugs. In other words, the cartels, the meddling business, the whole of the breakdown in Colombia, the consequences for southern United States, the effect on Mexico, the fact that these, that I don't know, some phenomenal, I read last year, like 20% of the money floating around in offshore, the offshore financial industry is supposed to be drugs related. I've seen figures, I don't know where they get them, Ivan, but I've seen figures that are absolutely astronomical in relation to these things. And isn't it about time that we copped ourselves on, realised that the drug war was lost about 25 years ago, and that we should take another tack and sort this out now?
Let's take some texts. You're listening to News Talk Breakfast. We're asking the question this morning, should drugs be decriminalised? We have Dr. Phil Tormey, consultant chemical pathologist, and we have Mary Byrne, founder and director of the Ashling Group International. Some texts. If you want to end drug crime or prevent children accessing drugs, you need to legalise it. Learn your history. Prohibition, anyone says. Adam, it's not programmes, it's not methadone clinics, it's parents having a hold of their children and good education. Hi guys, love the show. What I don't understand is why the government don't decriminalise marijuana. Like in Holland, if the government decriminalised it, they could tax it, so earn income from opening up new sources of funds for the exchequer, while also removing a source of income from dealers and freeing up time for the Gardaí to really crack down on it, rather than chasing small fry. It also opens up tourism, the SME sector. Ivan, take it from someone who grew up in what was the most drug-tolerant country in Europe. It does not work. Even the Netherlands has now reversed their policies and is clamping down hard on drugs, Everton Coolborn says. And finally, a close friend of mine died from drug use. He started smoking hash, but the dealers and criminals led him to harder drugs mixed with dangerous chemicals. Is that not a salient point? That, you know, people might make a case for cannabis or some of the softer drugs, but you're on the slippery slope, Mary. Is that not the case?
Yeah, I think for a start, I was at a conference in the European Parliament, and it was by the legalisers, and basically they said keep using words that people will play down the seriousness of drugs. For instance, using soft in relation to cannabis for a start, using recreational, and you can hear it, they're buzzwords in the media now, and it differentiate between a drug and its serious consequences from it. But I find with young people coming into us, and it's not about sending them to the joy, and I don't think anybody wants to send them there, it's about when they're arrested, for instance, it's a great intervention to get them in. And many of the courts refer them back to us so that we can help work with them, because it's not about the drug
it's
use.
It's a lot more serious
excuse
than that.
Me,
for something as trivial as...
Excuse me, I'm not finished.
Go on, yeah.
So what I'm saying is that young people come into our programme and they come off drugs, and that's the bottom line. But there are only a couple of our programmes in the country. Now, if you have something that effectively works, why would you not increase that? And my other problem is that in Sweden, the lowest rate in Europe, and I've said this to many of the ministers in the past, including some from the party in Fine Gael, and they would agree that Sweden is one of the lowest rates. It does the complete opposite. It's restrictive. It doesn't give prison sentence. It gives them drug-free programs, helps take them off drugs, and I'm all for harm reduction through not using, if at all possible, and we're using, helping people to come off it.
In Ireland, the judiciary is independent, and if you provide them with laws and with the ability to send people to prison, they take that. Judges vary hugely in their sentencing policies, and it seems to me that the consequences of some person of 19 years of age being arrested for smoking cannabis or for having a few joints in their pocket, the consequences are that they will not be able to get a job in the famed public sector, Ivan, because they will fail the police vetting. They will not be able to get a visa to go into the United States. Do you remember John Lennon and the whole nonsense that happened in the past? The consequences for something as trivial as that are horrendous, disproportionate and absurd. And I think that individualising your experiences, Marie, with the Aisling Project and what you're doing is very legitimate and very praiseworthy, but it doesn't actually address the massive problem that is out there, because you're addressing it at the less than 1% on what you're doing.
But even explaining that bill, you call taking cannabis trivial. Is that not a
It is
a
relatively trivial. Of course
judgmental,
it's not trivial.
It is trivial, and I tell you why it's trivial.
It is.
If you intoxicate yourself, you will recover in 99.9% of cases. That is a fact. People who take opiates don't all end up as addicts. People who snort cocaine don't all die from it, or don't all suffer diabolical consequences.
Can you tell which ones will?
Because
that is a good point, Bill.
That because they don't all die from it. The difficulty for drugs is because the effect varies on each individual depending on frequency of use. For example, you can desensitize yourself to a whole lot of drugs. Then the tragedies that I have seen, and I've seen it in patients of my own who've actually been found dead from going off heroin for 6 months, and then suddenly taking the same amount of heroin they thought that they had been taking before they went off it, and their whole body has changed in the meanwhile, and they die from respiratory arrest, or they just flake out. I have seen that, and the difficulty with all of this is that this is a consequence of an illicit, illegal drugs culture where people do not know what they're doing and are willing to take massive risks with their health as a consequence of it.
Okay, well, you're listening to News Talk Breakfast, and I'm going to just get our guest to stick on their headphones there. Murray Byrne, founder and director of Aisling Group International, and the voice you were just listening to, Dr. Bill Tormey, consultant chemical pathologist at Beaumont and Connolly Hospitals. 1890 453 106 is our low-call number, and Anne is on the News Talk comment line. Anne, good morning.
Good morning.
And good to speak to you. Do you agree with Bill on this argument drugs should be legalised?
Yes, I do. And I find myself sort of slightly shocked at saying that. But I'm a much older person now, and I've changed my mind around that. I feel that it would be better for society in general if drugs were legalised. I think in Ireland we live in a very addictive society with a high tolerance to the addiction drug of choice in this country that's legalised is drink. And that's legal. And we have horrendous problems because of it. And I feel that really the newer generation, they're cross-addicted, with drugs being the drug of choice, if you wish.
Yeah.
And I just feel that if it was legalised, there would be more control, as there is in the drinks industry. But I just feel there would be a higher awareness, and you know, you're not going to prevent anybody getting addicted, as the doctor said.
And do you have children?
I do.
Are they adult age, or like, would they be
young adults? Yeah.
Would you support them, say, moderately taking a drink at a family occasion or something?
Oh yes, I'm not anti anything, but I agree with the doctor. You don't know who's going to become addicted to something or not, you know?
Yes.
But the thing in this country is that, you know, there is a culture of drink addiction, if you want.
Oh, no, I agree with that, but I'm just wondering, would you be okay with your children, say, having a glass of wine or a beer or something like that in a social capacity?
Yes, I do feel that my children do have a high awareness, and because I think I also trust my children to drink sensibly, if you wish, and they're not what I would call go out into the pub, young people, and have a drinking competition.
But Anne, if the drugs were legalised in the shop, would you support your children doing a line of cocaine legally?
Well, I wouldn't. I mean, that's the thing. I wouldn't, but I would hope, you know, that with good education programmes, that, you know, kids will still have to make a choice, you know, regardless of whether it's legal or not legal, you know, and kids are going to try stuff. And you're not going to be able to prevent that. All you can hope for is that they will make good choices, you know, and if not, and they become addicted to any substance, that the program and the help is there, and that there's no shame around that, that they are able to access this help.
Okay, Anne, thanks for your comment.
Now, another caller on the News Talk comment line is Sharon. Good morning to you, Sharon.
Hi, Ivan, how's it going?
Good. How are you? You feel we can't control the legal drugs, so it'd be hard to control the illegal ones.
That's right. I've come across kids as young as 10 drinking out of cans in Temple Bar, and I'm coming from the perspective of someone who actually gave up alcohol 6 years ago, and I just feel that kids, these, you know, they're totally, I mean, they're available in spa, they're available in garages, alcohol is available literally everywhere, and I actually don't feel safe walking around Dublin City Centre after a certain time, and Enda Kenny is very unlikely to be walking around Abbey Street or Connolly Street at 8 o'clock in the evening, so it's through listening to programmes like yours that, you know, you kind of get an idea of what's going on, so...
But if you're saying there's a problem with alcohol and you're concerned about that, surely two wrongs don't make a right. Making other harmful substances available will just add to the problem, surely.
Yeah, well, I totally agree, because, I mean, I do drama workshops in the lab in Foley Street, and I have to walk up Abbey Street at around 9:30 in the evening, and even going there at 6:30. And I just see, you know, groups of people off their heads on drugs and drink. And I don't feel safe. And I know it's actually, it's very illegal, but I carry like a little small kind of knife to kind of protect myself. And, you know, I know it's illegal, but
I shouldn't do that, Sharon. We won't support someone carrying a knife.
But that's how threatened I feel when I walk up certain streets at a certain hour. And I think it's time for Enda to come in and do something about this, because I really can't see the situation changing unless he either has a total zero policy.
That's a Public Order Act problem.
Yeah.
Okay, Sharon.
That's not a drugs problem. There's confusion in society about public order issues and drugs, etc. In other words, you're looking at secondary consequences of addictions and secondary consequences of intoxication, Ivan, and you're equating that with making a law to prevent all of these things. There's Public Order Acts that should be enforced, and it should not be an excuse. Drink should not be an excuse, or any other intoxicant should not be an excuse for attacking people in the street. There's just absolutely no way. There should be zero tolerance. Sorry for that word, but there should be little tolerance of any violence in the streets, in my opinion. That's a different thing altogether from arresting people and shaking them down to find cannabis cigarettes in their pockets.
You're listening to News Talk Breakfast. The time is 9:34. We're going to follow up on those public order issues of drug taking after the break. You're most welcome back to News Talk Breakfast on this beautiful Sunday morning. The time just coming up to 9:37. This morning we're asking the question, should drugs be legalised? We have Dr. Bill Tormey, consultant chemical pathologist, arguing in favour, and against such a legal change is Mary Byrne, founder and director of the Ashling Group International. We're moving towards the end of this discussion.
There have been huge consequences, Ivan, that have never been talked about in public in this as well. I'll tell you one of them that exercises the hell out of me is a coroner at an inquest ruled that a man with cannabis in his urine had contributed to his own death and had caused myocardial infarction on the basis of an extremely bad paper published by the Harvard Medical School in an American journal with very few cases, with six cases, and anecdotal, and I thought it was absolutely disgraceful. And it was brought to the Court of Appeal, and the Court of Appeal threw it out on the basis that the procedure that the inquest went through was actually correct.
Okay.
But the conclusions, it's a bit like saying that the procedure, that there was a referee at the match against Wales, but unfortunately the referee didn't notice the ball went into touch and landed in the stand. And that level of bad decision has been made in this country because of prejudice about some of these substances.
But the whole Jerry Ryan thing was also seriously
out to lunch in my estimation too, because I went through the whole thing and I'm very, very concerned about prejudice replacing science in all of these issues, and that's the reason that I am advocating harm reduction.
Okay, but just say we follow your course and say you wake up one morning in Ireland and you legalise these drugs. For me, a simple person who hasn't taken drugs, my moral compass of do's and don'ts is the legal code. If you know, you can take a drink, but you can't drink and drive. It's simple, right? And I try and live my life as best I can according to that. If you legalise it, you're actually saying to me, well, in terms of the morality of it, taking drugs is not a bad thing. But at the same breath, you say it is a bad thing.
No, my legal code is, my morality, my moral code is not the law. My moral code has never been the law. How could your moral code be the law when you look at what goes on in Texas, frying people in electric chairs? How could you possibly say that, that just because that's law, that it's moral?
No, what I'm saying is,
I'm telling you that your comment about your own particular compass depends on the law. Mine doesn't.
Well, sorry. If you're trying to bring up children and you have a societal do's and don'ts.
Yes.
A black and white situation is what's legal and what's illegal. Surely by legalizing drugs, you fundamentally alter something that is, you know, ostensibly
you don't change. You don't change anything. You change the consequences of certain actions. I don't go home and tell my children who are adults that they should be drinking or that they should be smoking or that they should be taking drugs. I tell them quite the contrary, but that doesn't mean that one or two of my children can't can themselves out of it drinking vodka before they go out to nightclubs and stuff like that. They've now stopped, but there is nothing I could have done about it other than become completely ogre like and I won't interfere with the rights of my children, but I will tell them that their behaviour is completely ridiculous.
But Phil, you accepted earlier that under your plan more people would take drugs.
Of course they would, because I'm not going to tell you a scientific nonsense. It is quite clear that if you have more drugs on the street or more access to alcohol, that more people will take it. I am trying to say that in terms of societal harm, you license and you control the outlets. You try and decriminalise the whole thing so that you take it away from the drugs war and the gang cartels, the minor which obviously in places like Finglas where I represent, where there's a huge murder rate as a consequence of this, and people are dehumanised by calling it gangland. The word gangland is used so that polite society can actually subhumanize people who are being murdered in the street or murdering each other and say, oh, it's okay because it's them. And then you get some young light like Anthony Campbell, who's murdered when he's doing his job in Scribblestown in Finglas, just because he happens to be in the wrong place at the wrong time and recognises somebody who's about to murder somebody else in the house. So there's all these societal problems, and I'm not making this out to be trivial. Quite the contrary. I take this hugely seriously, because there's nothing in it politically for me to say something that's unpopular, and I'm not looking for notice, because I've written about this for 20 years ago, and I published it in a book in 2003.
What I think is that if you're talking about you know, decriminalising and that, what you're saying is that there'd be an increase in drugs. And what I've noted, and I know you said earlier I might deal only with 1% of that, I don't actually. I deal with national policy, and I was brought in by the Australian government for the review of their national policy as well, because they were looking at moving away from harm reduction towards looking at the Swedish model, which had the lowest rate of drug use by its effects. And one of the problems they had as well is that they had an increase in...
Mary, governments are determined. Action by a government depends on the prejudice of the people that are...
Oh, I think that's a very obnoxious statement to make about people in a country.
No,
no, I do actually. It's very condescending.
Dependent. The attitude of a government depends on who's elected, and it's going to vary from party to party and from person to person.
Well, I won't support your view, that's for sure, because I've seen the effects of that in Europe. And truthfully, I think it's very condescending to speak about a nation like that, because it's Irish people who have stood up and asked for change in relation to corruption and so on. It is other countries. You see them at the moment all over the world. world doing it. It's very condescending to say that.
To say what?
That the government, you know, they're the ones. It's not. The government
the government, it's a fact. I'm stating a fact. If you get a whole bunch of right-wingers in power, they're going to behave in a right-wing fashion. If you get a whole bunch of left-wingers in power, they're going to behave in a contrary
but
fashion.
But what I'm saying
that's
is...
That's life. Yes. C'est la vie.
No, it's not.
It's just a fact.
That's a dictatorship. But
it's not.
What I'm speaking...
Okay, let Mary finish.
What
the people
speaking,
say. Let Mary finish.
Well, that is, because you never listen. So what I'm saying is that people...
I do listen all the time.
Well, could you listen now?
I am, because you're talking...
No,
that
listen,
doesn't mean
then.
That I have
no,
to
no,
agree
no.
with
See,
you.
That's what I mean about condescending. Okay. You run people down.
I'm not
it's not
being
nice.
Condescending. You're trying to tell me what I'm saying is wrong.
Mary,
it's a
Mary
fact.
I wanted... There was one point that Bill made there. I just want to take up on. She spoke about Gerry Ryan and Katie French. Is there an ambivalent attitude towards drug taking? In other words, it's okay for a social elite to take drugs, but when it's in Finglas and there's shootings, it's a different story. Is there ambivalence and double standards there?
There are, of course. There's a snobbery in drug use, and there's a snobbery around cocaine use. And we get it whether it's in the medical profession, the media, and otherwise. People, if you say that it's heroin, there's a snobbery among drug use in general, among drug addicts and users. And it's not about... and making them into criminals. I don't give a toss about that. What I do feel, though, is you do have to have... Will you just
let Mary finish, Bill.
You're so rude sometimes.
I'm not. I'm just saying you don't... You've just said you don't give a toss about making them into criminals.
Let her finish the point.
You didn't listen.
I'm listening to you very loud and clear. I've repeated
Bill, let Mary finish the point. Mary, go ahead,
because we're nearly out of time.
Anyway, I'll let people make a judgment on whether you listened or not. What I'm saying is that... I don't care in the sense that that's not my primary aim. My primary aim is about them staying alive and about people having a right to live. And it's also the non-users having a right. And that also means people taking responsibility for their actions when they use drugs.
Has it ever occurred to you
and
that more
that,
people would stay alive if they were legalised than if they
actually,
weren't? Because you would have a lot less people with HIV,
no,
hepatitis
that's not true.
B.
Not true.
It is a fact.
Not true.
It is a fact.
100%
okay.
increase.
Also people
right.
who wouldn't deal
right.
with MDMA because they don't
my,
know what they're doing.
My mother was hit by a drunk driver. She had her right leg cut off. It was severed on impact. And that was by somebody using legal drugs. And I'm fully aware of the consequence when she died 4 years later, of the consequences of somebody not taking responsibility for the drug use when it's legalised.
Okay.
I'm not trying to criminalise. I'm trying to help young people stay alive. And they're not doing that in this country. And
I'm trying to stay employed here. And my producer's in my ear to say there's no quarter to ten and we must finish this job. I want to thank Dr. Bill Tormey, consultant chemical pathologist in Beaumont and Connolly Hospitals, and a Fine Gael nominee to the Senate, standing for election, and Mary Byrne, founder and director of the Ashton Group International, for that debate on drugs. I'm sure it will run and run, and it's a subject that we will return to. Thank you both for joining in the studio, and thank you all for your texts and phone calls on this controversial topic.